Having said that, I'm a technical minister, I'm not a politician. By education, I believe expectation should be proportional to difficulty. So gathering 190...
That's a very political answer. Well, perhaps more of a diplomatic answer.
I'm going into the numbers, believe me. Gathering 195 countries around the table with very different instances and problems, the definition itself of the ecological transition is different whether you're in Europe or you're in Central Africa. I believe that what we got is it's the reasonable compromise, but this compromise could not be that strong in the end of the day. So let's say the good points are that everybody agreed that we have to keep the acceleration towards 1.5 centigrades alive. This half degree decrease in the global target, it means a lot. It means that in certain areas of the planet, we will keep maybe 3 degrees less in the next 30 years. The second point is that there was some step forward in terms of transparency and the rules for the future management of the finances. Okay, to be honest, I understood that this was the best that could have been done. But in general, if I stay in the socks of the vulnerable countries, I am sure that they are not satisfied. We didn't succeed in getting the 100 billion contribution. We didn't succeed in mobilizing more money. There is a general statement about the fact that we have to increase our effort as advanced countries. But, well, you know, facts should follow the statements and the rules. And finally, I think some important differences emerged in the comparison, in the discussion. And I understand the instances of China, of India, and other big countries having a fossil fuel manufacturing that is more recent than the one we had in Europe, for instance. So there is a different need of time for different countries. This is very difficult to combine, I understand, but I also understand that it's a realistic problem. We have to face it, and we have to discuss how to make it in the future.
You've mentioned China and India, and as you know, the big issue was fossil fuels, and especially coal. Although the language was watered down, this was the first COP, I think, to make specific decisions on coal and fossil fuels. So would you say that was at least something of a breakthrough?
Sure. You know, I'm a physicist. What is important is not the instantaneous speed, but it's the average speed. We all agreed that we have to go to 1.5 by, let's say, mid-century, even though the date is not yet fixed, but around mid-century. That means that we can achieve this result with different speeds. Maybe somebody will be slower at the beginning, somebody will be faster. Italy can be faster because we have already a background in decarbonization. Some other countries, especially the very big countries, might need more time at the very beginning. But what is important is that we land at 1.5 in due time altogether. So I want to see the half glass full. And I think it's very important that everybody agreed on 1.5. And even though we had to smooth a little bit from phase out to phase down, I'm confident that we all agree that by the mid-century, around mid-century, we have to be at 1.5. So what is important is the pathway to reach 1.5, not what happens exactly tomorrow, but what we do during the pathway. And I want to be optimistic, and I think that everybody wants to be at 1.5 at the right time.
The UN Secretary General, Antonio Guterres, admitted that this final approved text were a compromise. Was a compromise somehow always inevitable? Certainly on these big set piece events, it invariably ends in compromise, doesn't it?
Yeah. I believe that the compromise was needed. I mean, imagine the opposite. We don't agree because we don't agree on a specific issue, and then we don't reach a global agreement. So what would have happened the day after? Everybody going on his own? That would have been a disaster. We need a unified world in this respect. We might step a little bit down on the date or on the language, but we should be all on board when we say 1.5 by mid-century. And I'm sure that technology will provide us with new solutions in the next 10, 12 years so that it will be even easier to accomplish the 1.5 in due time. And let's keep the good part. We needed to be all on board. It would have been not acceptable to split in such an important moment.
I mean, you're talking about solidarity. And you've said that you don't think the world has really seen the importance of solidarity to fight climate change. How can you help change that? How can you help rectify that?
Yeah, honestly, I was not at all happy in realizing that we were not able to accomplish the 100 billion target, you know, the financial aid for the vulnerable countries promised in 2015, and after 6 years, not yet accomplished. Okay, there was the COVID in the middle that didn't make, you know, didn't make things easier. But anyway, this was not a good excuse. So this I didn't like at all. And the second thing that worries me a little bit is that when we talk about finance, green finance, I think we should clarify there is a very ethic finance that we should develop, but finance can also be getting rich out of the carbon market, for instance. I don't think this at the moment is good. At the moment, we really have to diminish global inequalities. So solidarity and green finance and ethic finance is very necessary. So my first point is vulnerable rich countries should support vulnerable countries as soon as possible with 100 billions. It's not acceptable that we were not able to collect 100 billions. The 100 billions from the public should leverage much more money from the private through public-private partnerships. And it's impossible to reach the needed trillion range if the private will not cooperate with the public. So in this respect, it is very important that what the public, the states are doing will be perceived as the start, as a spark to gather more money for fundraising, because we need a lot more money to reduce global inequalities. We cannot separate global inequalities by climate change. I mean, I hope this is clear to everybody.
There were some agreements, as you know, like the rules for a carbon market that was made at COP26. But the UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson said afterwards, we can encourage, but we cannot force sovereign nations to do what they don't want to do. And that's a big problem, isn't it?
Well, in some sense, national sovereignty, as a matter of fact, we have to respect the decisions. But I think one of the good points of the COP is that all countries were sitting around the table, and in the end of the day, we shared a global common objective, which is an umbrella objective. Now, within this umbrella objective, of course, we have to coexist with the national sovereignty, but if we all agreed about the decarbonization in order to be mid-century at 1.5 degrees in temperature increase, well, in different ways, but we all have to go there. So I think that we should distinguish. Respecting national sovereignty is, of course, compulsory, but on the other hand, all nations, all countries got some commitment. So we should see, we should accept the fact that all countries have accepted the common shared target. So the two things can coexist.
Looking forward to Egypt and COP27. I know we've only just finished COP26. Are you at all hopeful that a lot more can or will have been achieved by the time the great and the good meet in Egypt for COP27?
Okay, I'll be very straight. We made the rules, we made the transparency, we made all the legal frame. How to say, the box, the container is perfect. Now I want to see the content. So in Egypt, there will be no more excuse. There must be the content into the container. So we have the rules, and we need now the money and the actions onto which we apply the rules. So we have 1 year time to go from the legal frame, from the rules and transparency and language into the actions. It's another challenge. It's a challenge in the challenge.
Roberto Cingolani, many thanks to you for joining us on The Agenda.
Thank you.